It's Wednesday, it's 7 o'clock, it's time for Magic TV. I'm Mashi Scanlon, the guy on the left. With me, Paul Cheon, Helmpf, behind the camera. We've got our own Magic TV intern, Big Worm, and of course, it's not Magic TV without Darksteel Humphrey. We have a great show lined up for you tonight. We were just putting the finishing touches on it as I speak. But we've got GP Denver prep, you know, that ever-present standard discussion. But yeah, GP Denver prep.
Not a lot's changed, but some new players in the mix. Mm-hmm. And it'll be interesting to see kind of how the metagame shakes down for this GP outside of the two major players.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, it's always good to see these GPs, you know, come out. So
well, there's like a Magic Online metagame, and then there's the real life metagame.
That's always the case, though. That's
yeah, yeah. And the thing is, since I focus mostly on Magic Online, I need to try to like figure out what the real life metagame is going to be, because
sure,
a lot of times the Magic Online metagame is a couple weeks ahead.
Right. You can't take that for gospel, and that's where you play most of your Magic, obviously. Yeah. We'll also talk about Modern versus Standard. Is Modern going to surpass Standard as the most popular format to play Magic? Then there was this little Aether Revolt. I can't even say preview. A legitimate spoiler.
Actual spoilers.
Mm-hmm. For Aether Revolt, there was a little game day poster that made its way onto the interweb. And then finally, we will have this week's top eight. Before we get into any of that, I want to remind you that Magic TV and all of our Magic TV top eights are brought to you by ChannelFireball.com. Welcome back after all a right. short hiatus. We were just getting into the standard metagame. And of course, we spoke about this recently. Was it last week we talked about standard?
Well, no, last week we were both on Thanksgiving vacation.
That's true. How was Thanksgiving for you, by the way?
Thanksgiving was good. I was we basically left Monday evening and was gone for the entire week. We came back Sunday. The drive was pretty bad because Jake is actually a pretty mellow baby, but when he is restrained, when he's in the car, because most kids are good in cars, they just pass out. Jake hates being restrained, so he was just crying for hours and hours. But once we got there, it was nice. You know, I spent time with Lisa's side of the family. Then we went over to Palm Springs with our side of the family, and it was great. It was great. And instead of turkey, we had Korean barbecue, so it was way better.
I have to agree with that. Very, very, very few pieces of turkey are better than Korean barbecue. What were you guys in Palm Springs?
Just in Palm Springs. I don't really have a good idea. Kind of general location. All I know is we were staying at this like Korean-ish hotel.
Oh gosh.
We a place where we could like bring food, so everybody made food, showed up, we ate. You know, then we went up to we went up the mountain.
Uh-huh.
Is that thing called?
Gondola? Is that what it was?
No, it wasn't a gondola. It's it's not a tram. It's this is the cable thing.
Okay.
All the way to the top of the mountain. There was actually snow up there, so we got to see a little bit of that. Anyways, it was a lot of fun. How was your Thanksgiving?
My Thanksgiving, it was interesting. I was in the Philippines for Thanksgiving.
You were in the Philippines?
Yeah, my dad lives there.
Oh.
So it was an interesting trip. A little bit of culture shock. Was afraid of drinking the water. So had a lot of soda.
The food's real cheap, though, I heard.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, everything was very inexpensive.
Yeah, yeah.
Had some delicious food. Tried some new things that I hadn't had before. Some of it was amazing. Some of it was not amazing.
Oh, yeah. That's I've always wanted to go to the Philippines. You know, when I used to work in Curacao, we actually had an office in Manila,
mm-hmm.
and I was always like interested to kind of go down there, but just never really.
Didn't quite make it.
Didn't quite, yeah, get
there. It's too late now, dude.
It is way too late now. I was going to go there when I was single, and it was going to be a lot of fun.
Yeah, yeah,
then one time, at least, I'm like, going to Manila is probably not a good idea.
Well, we're both back. Okay, so let's talk. Prior to Thanksgiving, we did have a discussion about Standard.
Right.
And, of course, at that time, I think our front runners were Blue-White Spirits and Black-Green Delirium.
Yeah.
Not much has really changed since then. Although at the time I do remember you were still lamenting this decision to play Marvels,
mm-hmm.
And you were talking about the comeback of Marvels, a different version of Marvels, a red green Marvels, and that's actually become a thing now.
Yeah. So the top two decks still clearly you have Blue White Flash, Green Black Delirium. The results just prove it. It's just a huge portion of the metagame. Both of those decks combined make up for roughly 50% of the metagame, mm-hmm. And it's the Green Black Delirium control deck and the Blue White Flash deck, and they're matched up pretty evenly. Green Black is a little bit better against aggressive decks,
sure,
because of Ishkana,
right?
And it's just very good at mucking up the ground and then taking over the game. It has more removal, whereas Blue White is better against various combo and control decks.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, Green Black has been pretty popular because a lot of people think, okay, well, Ishkana's also good against blue-white flash. So, clearly you should be playing green-black. And green-black's been dominating tournaments. I think Brad Nelson might have won back-to-back two big tournaments with green-black Delirium. So there's this other deck that's been picking up a lot more popularity on Magic Online, at least. It really hasn't been putting up as many results in real life, but on Magic Online, it's the person with the most trophies in the competitive standard leagues is Jabberwocky at 31,
Before we get into that, how many trophies do you have?
I have two.
What's going on here, man? Two?
Well, when I was gone all of last week, I didn't play any Magic whatsoever. And also, I just don't play as much Magic as these grinders. Like, you know, I'll stream for 6 hours, maybe play two leagues. These people play much faster than I do and play like 12 hours a day.
Jeez.
So,
but
yeah,
two,
but that, I mean,
two, Paul?
Yeah, I don't have a lot. I'm trying out a lot of different decks.
Okay.
But anyways, yeah, the person with the most trophies plays Red Green Marvel. He's actually been streaming with it recently too. It's actually Reed Duke's cousin.
Oh wow.
Reed Duke's cousin, he won like.
I feel like this is Reed Duke in disguise, by the way.
No. It's Reed Duke's cousin, who's also qualified for the Pro Tour and whatnot. He's quite good, and So the way this Red Green Marvel deck, the reason why this Red Green Marvel deck was built was because it wanted to prey on the dominance of this the Green Black Delirium deck. It's like, man, if you want to play a fair game against Green-Black Delirium, well, it's got a pretty decent early game, and it's got a great late game because it can traverse for Emrakul.
Uh-huh.
How do you beat that deck? Well, Marvel.
Yeah.
You know, Marvel is a deck that we knew beat Delirium, crushed Delirium, back when we were testing for the Pro Tour. And, you know, basically, Logan has actually made adjustments because of the blue decks that exist. The blue-white flash deck exists, so, you know, Spellqueller is a really hard deck to deal with, or a card to deal with, rather. Mm-hmm. So instead of playing the blue cards, it's choosing to play more red for more removal.
Yep.
And it's going with, it also has a small Delirium sub-theme, and so that it can play Ishkana.
Mm-hmm.
So the combination of Ishkana and Harness Lightning makes it so that this deck is not quite as embarrassing against the blue decks. At the same time, even though it's less streamlined, it's a less linear version of the Marvel deck that we played at the Pro Tour, it's still a Marvel deck. It's still much faster at getting Emrakul into play than Green-Black Delirium. And,
right.
and Green-Black Delirium doesn't put enough pressure on this deck,
mm-hmm.
where like the Red Green deck will be able to do what it wants and win. And that's why it's been crushing. Because Green-Black Delirium was the number one deck, people started playing Red Green Marvel, which crushes Green-Black Delirium.
Right.
So it's actually a real deck. I know I was losing a lot with it, but it's actually a real deck. The problem now, though, is Flash has a favorable matchup against the Marvel deck, right?
Well, it's your classic rock, paper, scissors. Right,
and that's the thing. You have this like classic rock, paper, scissors. You look at a lot of other matchups, though, in Standard. They're all close, and they're all grindy matchups. You know, there's no like 70-30 matchup. Everything's like 60-40, maybe 55-45. But now that you have this Marvel deck that exists, there are some very polarizing matchups. For example, Delirium versus Marvel, probably like an 80-20 or 70-30,
jeez.
Right? Whereas now you have this Marvel deck, it can't be a counterspell.
Mm-hmm.
So if you play a blue control deck with Gear Hulks in it,
game over.
Yeah, you're going to also be a 70-30, maybe more, favorite against that deck.
Yeah.
So it's kind of interesting. I you know, this Marvel deck hasn't really had that much success in real life, but a lot of people have been playing it on Magic Online. Like, I've played against it a lot. So I'm kind of curious to see just how popular it's going to be in real life. Is it going to take a little bit of time to kind of catch up? Is it only going to be like 5% of the field because people aren't as aware of the deck? Or is it going to be a huge part of it?
Historically, when you see something that's that popular on Magic Online versus, you know, when it has a dominant, I shouldn't say dominant, when it has a much higher percentage of play on Modo versus real life, part of that is card cost. Is this a cheap deck to build on Magic Online or not?
Oh yeah, I mean it's way cheaper than building Green Black Delirium, for example.
So that's what I'm saying.
Grim Flare, Liliana, all those cards are super.
Sometimes
expensive.
That affects popularity, right? Like back when I was playing a lot of Magic Online, you'd always run into either like White Weenie or even more often whatever red aggro deck was out there, because red aggro, so cheap to build, no problem. And so all of a sudden you'd start changing your sideboard or your main deck choices based on all these friggin' aggro red decks that you're facing, and then you take that to FNM, when you take that to a GP, and you're like, oh my gosh, this is awful.
That is true. There is a different Modo metagame in the sense, like, people opt to play cheaper decks because, you know, people have collections in real life. So a lot of people who play online are like, well, why do I have to spend twice as much money to have the same collection on Moto? So I'm just going to play, you know, White Weenie, which is way cheaper, and just beat people that way. The thing is, right now, there isn't that cheap, super linear, aggressive deck that people play, right? You have your vehicles decks with smugglers, copters, and whatnot, but a lot of them are mostly kind of mid-rangey strategy. The Mardu vehicles deck is probably one of the more aggressive decks. There's also a red-black aggro deck. But again, all those decks play smugglers, copter. You just can't build a standard deck for like 10 tickets and just crush everybody.
Right.
At the same time, things on Magic Online are much cheaper than they are in real life.
Definitely.
Right? Yeah. So people, if you want to build a deck, you can just build a deck for like $100, maybe less. So. Other than maybe Green-Black Delirium, because the Planeswalkers are super expensive.
Right, it's got a bunch of mythics in it. So.
Right.
Well, one of my hidden goals every time I talk about Standard with you, Paul, is to at least have some discussion of Marvel, because I know how much you love that deck.
Every time, you know, whenever I test Standard, you know, I've played almost every single deck. I've tried out some vehicles, Mardu vehicles, Flash, Green, Black, Blue Control, and Marvel. And, you know, when I look at all these other decks and then I lose to the Marvel deck because I've been playing a lot of Green, Black, Delirium, I'm like, man, this Marvel deck, you know, I just keep losing it. Everybody's playing Delirium. Like, I don't
Please
understand.
Play it in Denver.
Let me, you know
Please
what?
Please play
you
Marvel
know what? I'm
going to
give it a shot. Then I play the deck.
You get blown out.
I just can't win a game.
Oh, my God.
Never hit off my Marvels.
How much
or sometimes I have a Marvel with one energy.
You need to play this in Denver. You need to play. You will win Grand Prix Denver if you play Marvel.
No, there's no. I'm not lucky enough to play this deck.
Oh, my God. Lucky Chion, come on.
No, that's not a thing.
Oh, my gosh. It would be Big Warp, how awesome would it be if Chion played Marvel? It would be so great if you did that. Give everyone what they want. Give everyone what they want.
I will say this. It is more of a deck than I gave it credit for when I first saw it, but I still think it's...
Let's be fair here. You didn't get very much credit, though.
Yeah. But I still think it's pretty inconsistent. Mm-hmm. And, like, again, if you can get the right combination of cards and you get the Marvel and you hit with the Marvel, it's a great deck.
Yeah, it's insane, right.
But the thing is, it's also got a pretty high whiff rate. Mm-hmm. And, that's just... Maybe if you, you know, just want to spike a tournament, get lucky.
Sure. You can try playing the deck. You can do it.
But,
okay.
I just haven't had good experiences with it. But because... You know, other good players are also racking up a ton of trophies with the deck. It's clearly a real deck. It's just not the deck that I've enjoyed playing.
Okay, so let's do some quick hits on Standard before we move off of it. One, vehicles, Boros or Mardu?
I've tried both. The Mardu deck is a little more aggressive. It's got 12 one-drops. Mm-hmm. And it actually recently won a Magic Online PTQ. Sandy Dog, he won with it, and the deck looks pretty solid. But I like the feel of the red white deck a little more. I've not been a huge fan of Aether Hub in a three color deck.
Uh-huh.
Like, sure, it helps fix your mana, but it's a one time thing.
Yeah, I was gonna say I hate that like Tendo Ice and Bridge, like one use and then done thing.
Exactly. I mean, you do get a few more uses because you have Harness Lightning.
Sure.
But I've just had games where the mana is much more awkward. Whereas the red white deck, a lot more streamlined. You can just two colors, no stress.
Yeah.
You just play
just
it.
Just go out there.
You know, it's also the deck that Reed Duke's actually been championing a ton.
Yeah.
Despite there being a lot of different options.
As soon as you mentioned Boros vehicles, I think of Reed Duke. And that
Which
dreamy
is crazy.
Hair,
so. Yeah. But both of those things are
true.
Of course,
hand in hand.
I think both are very viable options. I think Standard's actually in a pretty good spot. You know, I've said this before. Every time Standard rolls around, people always find a reason to complain about Standard. It right now, there's a lot of like very, very powerful things you could be doing, but it's scattered around.
Yeah.
Right? You can play your aggro deck with Copter. You can play your Flash deck with Gideon and Avacyn. And you can also play your Marvel deck. There's a little bit of something for everybody.
Well,
except Control. Control could use a little help.
I'm not sure. Yeah, please. I'm not sure. Maybe I've missed it, but I haven't felt that much complaining about this Standard format. I feel like people would like this Standard format. Maybe I'm wrong. I mean, let me know if I'm wrong. I mean, but that's my sense of it. You know, I mean, Theros Standard, there was a lot of complaining about a lot of things.
That was definitely worse. That was definitely worse. Mono Black Devotion. Yeah.
Blue White Control.
Those were the three decks. Yeah. So, right now, it is still just those two decks comprising half the field. So it still kind of has that feel to it, right? Because Blue White Flash is so good. Green Black Delirium is so good. And a lot of these creature decks are all very viable. There's not a lot of control decks. And, you know, partly it's because there's not a lot of good sweepers. We lost Languish. Yeah. That was huge.
Well, there's some coming up. Spoilers.
Losing Languish was huge. Fumigate is around, but five mana is expensive, right? And also, Selfless Spirit is a commonly played card.
Yes.
Is very good against Fumigate. So I think the combination of those two things means control isn't as good. Also, there's not a lot of good card draw in control as well.
Yeah.
We lost. Factor fiction type card anymore. You know, back then you could play Sphinx's Revelation, and that's when control was awesome because all you needed to do was stabilize until you cast Revelation, and then you win the game.
I remember it used to be, do I need to gain life right now or draw cards right now? And
Sphinx's
Revelation solved all that for you. You want to just do both?
Yeah.
So a few other quick hits. Then one is Aether. Is Marvel like a real deck? Is that a tier one deck? Just up or down? Yay or nay?
I'm still going to say nay, but I think I'm a little bit biased. Just based on the results, I think there are only there's two clear tier one decks. You have your blue-white flash decks, which has continued to impress me. Sure. I've only played it a little bit, and even when I play it, I'm like, man, I'm not sure this deck is good. And I just, every Green time, one. I'll just 4-1, okay. 4-1 leagues
well,
with
so this,
it.
Well, so this is my second quick hit, is Spirits or Green-Black Delirium.
Well, first of all, it's not really Spirits anymore. It's just Blue-White Flash.
So Blue-White Flash.
There's, no Spirit synergy whatsoever. Mm-hmm. It's just a couple of cards are Spirits now. There's no more Rattle Chains. But, I mean, honestly, it's play style, right? Both decks are very viable. And I think when you pair them against each other, it's very close. It's very skill intensive. So it's like, what kind of Magic do you prefer to play? Which is what I like, right? Because there's a little bit of something for everybody. Do you want to have these, grindy games where you're just trying to get every little edge, card advantage, then have this late game powerhouse that gives you inevitability, then you play green black. Or do you want to just say go, play a tempo game? Blue white plays a lot like the Delver deck, back in the day, and it's also very powerful, and it gets to play again one of the best cards in Standard, Gideon is still just completely absurd.
Yep.
Planeswalkers right now are just so hard to deal with. There's no good way to deal with Planeswalkers.
It's so funny, too, because, obviously we did top 8 cycles a few weeks ago, and one of them was the Lorwyn Planeswalker cycle. Yeah. And I think back to everything that we were told, everything we knew about Planeswalkers at the time, and the idea was not to make them so OP. They are so powerful. Every set, every Standard format has Planeswalkers you need to play. Planeswalkers are essential for Standard these days.
Yeah, I mean, you look at Gideon, Chandra. It took a little bit of time, but now she's being played again.
Yeah.
So you have Gideon, you have Chandra, and you have Liliana. All those cards have clearly been pushed. They're amazing, and there's not a lot of good answers to it. And that's the thing, right? Right now, we're in a metagame. I think Smuggler's Copter kind of ruined a lot of the how to attack aggressive decks, because now you need all instant speed removal to be able to kill Smuggler's Copter. At the same time, these Smuggler's Copter decks can also play Gideon, right?
Yeah.
And Ruinous Path is an answer to Gideon, but it's not going
to
kill Smuggler's Copter.
Anything to the copter,
right?
So now you're dead weight.
Yeah, so now you have we're in a world right now where there's a bunch of situational removal and counter spells to try to deal with these threats. So it seems to me that it's probably better to just be more proactive in this current format, because you just don't have a card that says counter target spell, or you don't have Hero's Downfall.
Well, yeah, you don't have that general answer. It's not all purpose. It's
situational. I think actually printing Hero's Downfall might be good for Standard, just because of how, no matter whatever deck I play, my opponent just plays a Planeswalker, and I'm just like, all right, I got to play the game, doing everything I can to kill this Planeswalker, because it's so hard. And even if you play a deck with Ruinous Path, you can only really afford to play two. And you're just like, God, I really hope I draw my Ruinous Path. And then other times they're sitting in your hand and you're
why did I draw this?
My opponent has two Smuggler's Copters. I can't possibly win. I have these Ruinous Paths in my hand. So yeah, I don't necessarily want them to scale back on the power level of Planeswalkers, because I think Planeswalkers are, just overall good for Magic. People just love powerful Planeswalkers. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, I want there to be more answers to Planeswalkers.
You want to balance it out that way. Keep
exactly.
The power level the same, but find answers.
Yeah, yeah. The thing is, right now, what they've been doing is they've been pushing Planeswalkers and creatures, and spells have been just getting worse and worse.
Yes. Definitely,
you know what I mean?
Definitely. The power creep is very lopsided that way.
Exactly.
So, okay, final thought on this then. Have you chosen your deck for Denver?
I have not, but I've narrowed it down to blue-white flash and green-black delirium.
And Marvel.
No, I'm not going to play Marvel.
Paul, what would it take for you to play Marvel at GP Denver.
If I like 503 leagues in a row, maybe.
All right, so tomorrow's stream, you'll be playing Marvel?
Well, I only have one more day.
Tomorrow's stream, you start
playing? I guess I can stream on Friday.
Yeah, hello.
No, I should probably focus on the other decks. God. I did play a lot of Green-Black Delirium yesterday, and see, this is my fear. I've been playing against, like right now on Moto, I've been playing against Marvel roughly 20% of the time, which I don't think is an accurate representation of what I'm going to see at the GP, right? But that's making me scared of playing green-black because I just keep losing to it.
Just play blue-white.
Yeah, but then that's the flip side. Blue-white's weaker matchups are like kind of the more like hyper-aggressive decks, and if people are opting to play these more aggressive decks and haven't caught on to it, like if people aren't playing Marvel, what are they playing? Right, and if it's aggressive decks, but then green black is a better choice.
Yeah, but I mean, you're talking. At a certain point, you're talking about the two best decks in the format, okay?
Yeah.
And there is some indication. I don't know if it, you know, to what level you can trust it. There's some indication that Marvel is popular because what you're seeing on Moto, which means you know, if because this every time we talk about this, you tell me that you know green black and blue white, they're roughly the same. They're kind of parity in terms of power level. So in that case, just go with blue-white. Go with blue-white. Big Worm, am I right? Blue-white, right?
Yes,
there you go. See? Boom. Two against one.
Well,
do blue-white.
I guess I should practice in blue-white then. Mashi told me what deck to play at the GP.
All right, well, from standard to modern, there's discussion now, you know, because every time there's, and you probably know this much better than I do, streaming modern, whenever there's modern to be seen, it's so popular. People want to watch modern.
Yes.
So how do you feel about modern versus standard? Is modern going to surpass standard in popularity?
I'm going to say no, but I think largely due to the fact that modern is so much more expensive than standard. At the same time, with the way the I guess they changed the announcements with the standard rotations.
Yeah.
But with the quick standard rotations, people were, you know, kind of like a salty taste in their mouth because they were just like, I just bought all these cards and now they're rotating out and the value crashes, right? So like you have to sell your cards quickly, so you don't really have a deck intact for too long.
Yeah, it's all liquid. It's just right? Like, yeah, boom, boom.
Now
boom,
for the competitive scene, it's nice, but for people who aren't quite as competitive, which is 99% of the Magic community, it feels bad. But at the same time, standard's way cheaper. Modern's so expensive. You know, but I've also noticed when I'm streaming or even if you watch coverage, Modern is the most viewed. You know, more people watch Modern than they watch Standard. People get kind of sick of Standard because they're just like, yeah, I play Standard all the time. I'm aware of all these matchups, blah, blah, blah. But when you see Modern, you're like, oh, there's all these cool decks. I don't really get an opportunity to play with them very much, maybe because of the price difference, you know.
Sure, sure.
But I get to see all these cool decks doing sweet things. Well, and you can do way more sweet things in Modern than you can.
The pool is so much wider and deeper in Modern.
Exactly.
You know, I mean, but there's ways, I guess, you know, we already see Wizards reacting to that to some degree with Modern Masters and Eternal Masters, really, you know, really for Legacy and Eternal formats, but not for Modern. But, you know, they could do more. If there's more Modern Masters out there, do you think, if I understand what you're saying, but for price point, Modern certainly would surpass Standard.
Yes, because just based on what people like to watch, right? Because I think if you want like, you know, if you're just a person interested in watching like good competitive tight play and whatever, then Standard I think is better because the games are grindier. Grindier games tend to lead to more decisions,
sure.
So better players tend to win. Mm-hmm. Whereas, you know, in Modern there's a lot more linear decks, right? And people are like killing each other on turn three and doing all kinds of crazy things. Mm-hmm. But I think from a viewer's perspective, that's more fun to watch.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Right.
Watching somebody
get... There's so much more excitement.
Yeah. Does he have the Splinter Twin? Does he, you know... Oh my God, Dredge killed on turn three. That is just way more entertaining to watch instead of watching somebody go, okay, so he played a Tireless Tracker, cracks a clue. He also plays Tireless Tracker. Evolving Wilds, two clues. Yeah. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. That is just not fun to watch. You know, I think, again, Standard is more skill testing, but the reason why Modern will be more popular, at least in terms of just viewer count, is because Modern is just way more fun to watch.
Sure.
Just personally, too. I enjoy watching Modern. I even like playing Modern more, too, just because, I mean, sure, I get killed on turn three, but it's still just fun to me. It's more fun to me.
Sometimes you kill on turn three.
Exactly.
Too. Yeah. So you'd rather stream Modern? That was going to be my next question anyways.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Whenever there's a Modern GP that I prepare for, I'm like, all right, I guess I can just only play Modern. And not only that, I mean, when I play Modern, the two things that I play, like people, I get the most views. That's Modern and Cube Draft. Those are the two things that people want to see the most out of everything that I do. Mm-hmm. You know, Standard, yeah, okay. Draft, meh. But Modern and Cube Draft.
Draft, what's more popular, Standard or Draft?
I think they're roughly equal, but Cube Drafts and Modern are...
Yeah, Cube Drafts are just awesome. I mean, watching anyone Cube Draft is just awesome.
Right.
Just like Cube Drafting is so great. So.
Yeah.
But that does not surprise me. Interesting, I thought you were going to go the other way. I mean, your reasoning for Modern not surpassing Standard, of course, is extremely valid.
Yeah, I think in terms of... Yeah, that's the thing. In terms of actual people who have decks and are playing on a regular basis, I feel like it's just way easier to build a Standard deck but if you talk about the pool of competitive players, I think people do prefer Modern.
I think so too. That's something that's, and there's so much popularity and buzz around Modern.
Yeah, but the thing is, if you're watching this website or, you know, the people that we hang out with, we're people who, you know, who've played Magic 40, 50 hours a week, think about Magic, talk about Magic. We're a much different group of people.
Sure.
Than...
I agree.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. But for
most... Exactly. So for most of the people watching, yeah, I think a lot of people are going to enjoy Modern. You know, I think overall, all of Magic, Standard.
Really?
I think more people are going to play Standard.
Oh, well, of course. It's just more accessible.
Exactly.
It's interesting, though. I wonder how much of that kind of feeds itself. You know, there is a certain mystique and aura around certain Modern cards and Modern decks because they are so unattainable for some people, for a large amount of people.
I can't afford... They need to reprint those fetch lands, you know?
I wouldn't run out there and start playing build a Modern Gauntlet. I can't afford to do that. I wouldn't want to invest
Scalding
that kind
Tarn.
Of money into
Scalding
it.
Scalding Tarn.
It's crazy.
Misty Rainforest. Aren't they like $80? You know what I mean?
I don't know. That's a question for Director of Sales and Marketing Tommy Adams. I am not sure what the price is.
Come on. You're there at the GPs every weekend.
I haven't been to the vendor booth in ages.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It's been a long time.
Oh, you're just kind of hanging out and doing...
Yeah, do nothing.
TO stuff.
Yeah.
Fair.
Yeah, TO stuff. I haven't drafted Kaladesh yet either, which is like a huge regret of mine. Channel Fireball president and CEO John Sasso is loving the Kaladesh draft. I don't know how you feel about it, but he's been drafting
a lot. Because I always just play formats based on what's coming up. I haven't really done a lot of Kaladesh Limited since the Pro Tour.
The Pro Tour, really.
Because I had the Modern GP to test for, and now I have the Standard GP to test for. Afterwards, I think it's like GP Louisville.
Legacy.
So, which is Legacy. Yeah, yeah. So, you know, I haven't booked a flight for that yet, but
San Jose
San Jose
limited?
San Jose is limited, but it's with the new set.
It's Aether Revolt sealed, right?
Right.
Yeah,
so I'm going to be doing that, then hopping on a plane to go to Dublin.
That's my plan. That's right. Oh, yeah, because it's local GP. After. You got
to
do that. Okay.
Yeah. Most people are just going to the GP, but I'm just like, it's literally like...
Yeah, you've got to.
Before I moved, it was literally across the street. It was like two blocks.
Yeah, because it's a convention. Yeah. That's right. So, well, speaking of Aether Revolt, there was a bit of a spoilage.
Yeah.
Earlier today, a game day poster got leaked. And, of course, the game day, for those not familiar with game day, you go out there, you play game day. If you win the game day tournament, you get a sweet playmat. And there's different game day promos, a participation promo.
So how does this get leaked? Like, is it a game store that gets these posters early?
No.
Or is it somebody from who works there?
I mean, I think...
And if they find out, that person gets fired, right?
Of course they do. I have no idea how it goes. I think sometimes things like this happen with none of the above. Someone at the printer shop. Someone at wherever they're producing the posters plays Magic.
What if Watsy leaks them early to build hype?
That is not happening. I will tell you this right now. Having gone through so much with them, that is not happening. So, but let's talk about these cards. You just mentioned the lack of mass removal. Well, it looks like they're going to solve that to some degree in Aether Revolt with Yahini's Expertise. 2 black, 2 other, sorcery. All creatures get -3/-3 until end of turn. You may cast a card from your hand with converted mana cost 3 or less without paying its cost. This thing sounds busted.
It feels Bloodbraid Elfish to me, you know what I mean?
In terms
of, this is a card that lets you cheat, right, in terms of mana. Mm-hmm. It seems ridiculous, right? I mean, it's not a card that necessarily you necessarily want like 4 of in a lot of these decks because, you know, you're going to be playing inside the Delirium decks and whatnot. But in the Delirium decks itself, this seems amazing.
Unbelievable, yeah.
You know, play 2 or 3 copies in the main, maybe even have up to 4 in the sideboard against aggressive strategies. But like, think about it. Like, you can play this and, you know, then drop a Liliana afterwards and kill the 4 toughness creature.
Yep.
On top of that. Mm-hmm. The fact that, again, it just lets you play a free spell is ridiculous.
That's what's mind-boggling.
And, like, I, you know, when you look at this card, you know, this is like a very unique ability, right? Are we going to see other cards
have
this?
Oh, I think
this?
So. I think so. This is one.
Then is Standard going to be broken?
I mean, it's...
Because that seems like it would be kind of silly. Because somebody who... The person who draws this gets so far ahead
yeah.
in terms of tempo.
But if there's other cards that do the same thing...
Yeah, so the person who draws more of these types of cards wins?
I mean...
Yeah, he drew three Bloodbraid Elves.
Do you not remember playing with Cascade? Do you not remember what that was like?
Yeah, it was horrible.
It was like not only what you draw, but what you hit. At least with this, you know what you're going to hit.
Right.
That Bloodbraid, sometimes you're like, oh, God, Esper Charm. Okay, I guess I'll just draw two. Or
yeah, well, that's the thing. I mean, this isn't giving you card advantage necessarily. No. Well, it does because it's a Wrath, right? But like, it gives you like just so much of a tempo advantage, right? You play against an aggro deck, and you play this. You've wiped the board, then you also have a threat. That's the problem with a lot of control decks is, like, you know, you tap out the player sweeper, and then they get to untap and they play something,
mm-hmm.
right? You're the first one person to have a permanent on the board after also the sweep effect.
Yeah.
My only concern maybe right now is because it's still, you know, this is still going to be part of the current standard, and you're looking at the current standard, and the top two decks, this isn't really that insane against the top two decks,
uh-huh.
necessarily. Like, the Blue-White Flash deck doesn't really need to overcommit. It is pretty good against Spellqueller,
yeah.
but it's, like, not going to be good against Green-Black for the most part. But it is a super powerful card, and the right metagame, you know...
This is
the type of card that will make people think twice about playing, like, Vehicles, for
exactly.
example.
This is the type of card that could change the metagame enough to make itself, you know, better, or start holding things back, like Vehicles, and have its impact felt by its presence, not by the fact that it's played. Never mind the fact. By the way, these cards have not been confirmed by Wizards of the Coast. This just hit social media and so went out there. But you know, that's for this card. If this is actually an ability in this set, it's insane.
Yeah.
It's just ridiculous, right? Like,
yeah, you can even play this, put a Tireless Tracker in play, or
cast
whatever.
A spell, put a creature, whatever you need to get done. You know,
yeah.
I mean, it's pretty unbelievable.
I'm just looking at this too, just like, you know, how you can build around this. Like, you just, even in your Delirium decks, you know, you just. Like, you can play this and have it be, like, your fourth type in your yard, and then, like, turn two Grimflayer, turn four this, and your Grimflayer still lives. Like,
yep.
It just synergizes so perfectly in that deck.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, it's just going to go in that deck. Now, the question is this a real card?
Yeah.
Because, again, this seems pretty absurd.
It seems pretty absurd. There's no question of that. The other one, so a few other cards were featured on this poster, and they seem a lot more reasonable. I will say this, with Yahini's expertise, one of the first pieces of you know, speculation that hit with this was, well, now you can Ancestral Vision too. So could this card see play in Modern?
No. Oh, yeah, and Legacy too, maybe.
Yeah, it's like -3/-3 Ancestral Vision. How do you feel about that? That's card advantage. That'll give you a little card advantage there, wouldn't it?
That would. That seems pretty sweet.
That does seem pretty sweet.
The question is that then I would, like, let's say you draw, like, the Visions on, like, turn three, and you're like, and you don't have the expertise in your hand, you're like, how lucky do I feel?
Do I run it or not? Do I run it or not? All right.
But that is a pretty sweet interaction.
That was kind of the most hyped interaction
right.
on the web. So
yeah, Wrath, draw three.
Yep.
No big deal.
No big deal. Yeah. Next up, Trophy Mage, 1/2 for a wizard. When Trophy Mage enters play, you can search your library for an artifact with converted mana cost 3. Almost said or less.
So the third in the cycle of the mages that search for artifacts, right?
Trinket, treasure, trophy.
And now the Trophy Mage.
And that kind of feels like a real Magic card no matter what, right? That feels legit, especially with the trinket, trophy, trinket, treasure, trophy kind of thing going on there.
Yeah, the question is, like, what makes a 3 converted mana cost artifact a trophy? You know, Trinket makes sense. You're getting a small, cheap thing. Treasure makes sense because you're getting, like, a big, expensive artifact.
Yeah, Paul, that is the question.
Hey, look.
It's very insightful. I'm glad.
Look.
The hard
Flavor Judge coming in.
And that's why you're watching Magic TV. The hard-hitting questions. What makes a 3-mana artifact a trophy?
Like, you look at the name. I'm just saying it doesn't really... I don't see it.
Why? Do you think it should... Well,
I don't know what the name should be.
Let's get into this. Is a trophy bigger than 3-mana cost or smaller than 3-mana cost?
I don't know. A trophy feels like it's a trinket to me.
Really?
It feels like trinket territory.
Says someone who I bet has no trophies.
I do have trophies.
You have some Grand Prix trophies.
And a Nationals trophy.
Are those trinkets?
That Nationals trophy is huge.
Are those trinkets?
The little GP trophies
those,
are trinkets.
Those are trinkets. But
the Nationals one is a trophy.
That's a trophy.
All right, that's fair.
Okay.
The hard-hitting
questions. We got there. Trophy.
All right, so all right, trophy.
One blue two for a 2/2. You go out and fetch a 3-mana artifact.
Right.
How do you feel about that?
I mean, it can be a potentially powerful effect. Maybe not in standard, but anytime you have a card that lets you search your library, obviously in the grander scale, like
sure.
You look at the scope of all of Magic, there's a lot of really awesome cards you can get.
I mean, think about all the amazing 3-mana costs.
So I imagine this deck's going to have a home somewhere, either in a casual format, modern. People will try to figure out a way to make it work. You can search for an Ensnaring Bridge and play it in your Lantern Control deck.
Boom, boom, boom. There you go.
It's a little slow, turn four Ensnaring Bridge, but I mean, you can whatever. Still do it.
You find it. It's your extra Ensnaring Bridge. You don't draw it, you find it this way. So it's certainly a powerful effect. Like all powerful effects, it's a matter of whether it finds that right home.
And if you get there in limited, that's awesome. If you can have, if you get like 2-3 artifacts.
It's insane.
Sweet value.
Yeah, I mean, it's completely, respective of what else is there, what you can get. But it's a powerful, powerful effect.
Well, yeah, because in limited, you can get,
I'm talking about standard, though. Even in standard, it's a matter of what you can get, what kind of utility you can get out of it. But
that's
the effect is powerful, and it's not expensive. Paying 3 mana for a 2/2 and then searching for a 3-mana artifact is actually a really good, very efficient use of mana.
Yeah, it's a pretty sweet deal. But I'm just thinking about limited. You can just get, a Renegade Freighter, and that's just good value right there.
Yeah, definitely.
You just get the choo-choo train and just beat them
choo-choo.
Down.
Choo-choo!
Oh, yeah.
And then finally, we have Scrap Trawler. Speaking of 3-mana artifacts. It's a 3-mana artifact creature. Whenever this creature or another artifact you control is put into a graveyard from the battlefield, return to your hand target artifact card in your graveyard with less converted mana cost. So when Paul blows up my Sol Ring, I can get back my Lotus. Or when you blow up my Colossus of Sardia, I can get back my Phyrexian Colossus.
This is a super cool card.
This card's awesome.
Yeah.
Maybe you want to get it with your Trophy Mage.
Yes. Playing against this as a control player... just seems nightmare. Again, we have to see kind of what the other cards in the set are, but this is a nice little grindy card.
I mean, it's just a matter of what other artifacts are out there.
Right.
I mean, think about
also,
this.
You need to get artifacts in your yard prior to this dying.
Yeah.
Right? So this is better kind of late game, but if you just play a turn 2 Scrap Heap Scrounger, turn 3 this thing, it's not going to really get you that much value.
Sure.
You can just kill this right away.
Well, how do you feel about this in Modern?
I guess people could try to play it in Affinity against decks that are trying to
I guess when it dies,
get you with removal.
When it dies, it'll get you Arcbound back, right? So.
Yeah. I guess if they try to kill it, you can sack your Ravager.
Well, if it's in play and you have a Ravager in play, there are a lot of value plays you can make as you sacrifice artifacts to get other artifacts back, right?
Right.
Because it's every artifact.
You're sacking, getting back.
So it's all of a sudden,
Yeah.
It is less, though. So it's not like you can start sacking Ornithopters, playing Ornithopters, sacking Ornithopter, playing Ornithopters.
Hey, maybe it's an okay cyborg card against decks like Jund decks or something. I'm not sure.
Yeah, but anything.
It might also be too slow because Modern's super fast.
It does feel a little too slow.
Is a grindy enough card where maybe it could see a home in Standard.
Here's the real question. The real question with Scrap Trawler. All right, Paul, and this is super important. Scrap Trawler, Trinket, or Trophy?
Neither?
It's 3-mana artifact. Would you consider it a Trinket or a Trophy? There's no neither. I didn't say neither. I said Trinket or Trophy.
When I think of a 3-mana 3/2 artifact creature, I don't think of it as a trophy. I would, like, if you...
So you're saying it's Trinket?
Sure.
You're insane! This thing is such a trophy! It's freaking 3-mana.
You were just
3/2.
Waiting for me. This was just a trap.
No.
This was a trap.
I would have agreed with trophy. I would have agreed with trophy.
Okay,
saying
fine.
Saying it's a trinket is unbelievable. Big Worm, am I wrong?
Is it a trophy?
Because it's freaking... Oh, well, okay. In a world, and I'm making this assumption, in this world...
Trophy,
live,
that name is just not right.
Trophies are better than trinkets, I believe.
Yeah. You know, it would make a little more sense if you can get non-creature artifact with that converted mana cost 3. Because you can't have a creature be a trophy.
Yeah, you can.
What's not? It's.
You ever heard the term trophy wife? Trophy
wife? I was thinking about it, but I don't want to say it.
I'm just going to put it out there.
I was thinking.
You got to cover both bases.
I was hoping maybe you would say it, but I didn't say it.
I mean, come on. So, there.
I don't want to objectify.
There's trophy dogs, too. Have you ever seen, people do that. They have,
They do have trophy dogs. But sure.
So, my point is this. This is definitely. I mean, it could be a treasure, really. Maybe that's the appropriate terminology for it.
Sure.
I can't believe he went with trinket. That's just insane to me. This is clearly in trophy plus territory. Card's good.
You got me.
Oh, God. You're the one who went off on trophies.
I was. That's why I was saying. No, I was saying that I disliked the name Trophy Mage because it doesn't fit. And Scrab Trawler, when you asked me that question, it explains why. I'm just like, no, this isn't a trophy.
Yeah, it's totally a trophy.
But when you play like, you know, like a super expensive artifact, you're like, oh yeah, that's treasure. Doesn't that feel like really? A treasure?
Black Lotus, does that feel like a treasure or a trinket?
It's a trinket.
A Black Lotus.
Yeah. It's a treasure.
That feels more
it's
like a treasure to me. I'm just saying. All right, come on.
But a trinket's supposed to be kind of like this little thing that has utility.
Mishra's Bauble.
Oh yeah, that's definitely a trinket.
That's a trinket. Oh yeah. Okay, that's a trinket. It's Sol Ring. Feels like a treasure. I'm just going to tell you that right now.
Well, maybe that's, you know, some trinkets can be treasures too. Right?
Fair enough. Fair enough. Some trinkets can be treasures too.
I am not wrong.
I bow to the wisdom of Paul Chian. Humph. Without question, some trinkets can be treasures too. I like that. All right. That is our Magic TV for the week. As we close on that, some trinkets can be treasures too. I think that's a little kernel of wisdom we can all take home with us this week and really think about all those things we come across that are trinkets, maybe just disguised treasures.
That's why you watch the show.
So that leaves us with this week's top 8.